the spirit of error. And those of you all that didn't, were not here, you can see it online as all of our services are streamed online. Or if you want to get the CD, you can get the CD. Praise the Lord. As we dealt with the spirit of error, I taught a Bible class years ago out of the book of Jude, where the writer talks about the spirit of Balaam, the spirit of Korah, and the spirit of Cain. Actually, he put it the way of Cain, the gainsaying of Korah, and the greed of Balaam. And so we dealt with those because those spirits or those attitudes are still existing today. The way of Cain has to do with false worship, worshiping God in a manner that the person wants to worship him and not worshiping him and giving God what his word declares he should be given. And then, of course, the gainsaying of Korah, which has to do with rising up against the authority in the church, particularly the pastor, and challenging the pastor and different things like that. That's what Korah did when he, in the, I think it's in the 22nd chapter of Numbers, or the 21st chapter of Numbers, one of those books, where he rose up and challenged Moses as the pastor. And then, of course, God dealt with him after that. And then you have the greed of Balaam, which Balaam was a prophet in the Old Testament. He was a preacher for hire. And Balak wanted him to curse Israel because he knew that Israel was coming at him and he could not defeat them because God was with him. And so he wanted Balaam to curse him because Balaam, whatever he said or prophesied, it seemed to come to pass. And of course, he said he could not curse the people because God said that they're blessed. And of course, he went to God three times, and God in his anger told him yes, but he had in his mind to cut him down by the angel that was riding the donkey. Or he was riding the donkey, and the angel was standing in the way with his sword drawn. So just because God says yes don't mean that that's the yes and you're good. But he was preacher for hire. He did what he did for money. And this is what we're dealing with today. So as you can see, all of those things are still operating today. And then you have the spirit of error. The spirit of error is a religious demon that comes to seduce an individual and making them think that they are doing what God wants them to do when it's completely contrary to God's word. God will never tell a person to do anything that is contrary to his word. And we know that because the Bible says he cannot deny himself. And that simply means that God cannot go back on his word. What he said, he has to uphold. And of course, God is the word. Can we say amen? Jesus was the Word made flesh, and Jesus is God. And so that's what we're dealing with today, a lot of spirit of error, a lot of people thinking that they're hearing from God or that God is telling them to do something, and it is contrary to the Scriptures. There are 37,173 verses in the Bible, 1,189 chapters, and of course, we told you before that all of the scriptures fit together like a chain. And of course, when someone feels that God is telling them to do something, whether it's by a dream or a vision, if it is of God, it would not conflict with any one of those verses or chapters or what God has said how things ought to be. But the spirit of error comes to convince a person, and it comes in a religious, spiritual form to make them think that they're hearing from God when actually they're not. And many times it's very difficult for those that know the order of God and know the way of God to convince them because they just completely believe that it is of God. And it is a very dangerous thing because the scripture talks about in the book of Timothy, I believe it is, or Thessalonians. I usually get those two books mixed up when it comes to this scripture. that God does give a strong delusion for a person to believe a lie. And the scripture says that they all might be damned. That's in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. And I think we should go there. And let's deal with this as a forethought before we get into our subject of corruption. I guess this does deal with corruption. Let's start at 2 Thessalonians chapter number 2. And we're going to deal with verse number 1 all the way down to verse number 12. Now, of course, we're going to ask you that no one be yelling out unruly and out of order. Can we say amen? And we don't want to do that. If you don't want to be put on the spot online, then don't do that. We got these shotgun mics up so that we can pick up the audience reading and any questions that you may have. It's all for the benefit of making our television sound more professional. And so we want everyone to read as we go through these scriptures, which is our custom. It's a custom I got from Bishop Paddock, who taught this way, and he got it from Bishop Haywood. This is how Bishop Haywood taught Bible class. He had everyone read. And so this is what I'm accustomed to. This is how I've been trained, because there are primarily three reasons why we ask you to read the word out loud for yourself. Number one, this train carries no sleepers. If you read out loud, you won't fall asleep. Let me say amen. You know, the second reason is that when you read it out loud for yourself, you won't be able to say that Second Bishop Johnson said it or anyone else said it. You'd have to say the word of God said it. And the scripture says the word is nigh thee. This is the third reason. The word is nigh thee, even in thy where? Mouth. And when you say the word out loud, it makes an impression upon you than it would make if you sat and read it silently. And of course, that's the best way to memorize scripture, by reading it out loud and allowing your ears to hear it out loud. And it makes an impression on you than it would not make if you just had somebody read it to you. And so this is what we wanted tonight. We want the word of the Lord in your mouths. And so we're going to read verse number 1. And since this is a long text, well, I think we'll read it straight through all the way to verse number 12. So 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 1 through 12. All right, and if we have it, let's read. Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, by our gathering together unto him, that ye be not soon shaken in mind or be troubled. Let's all read. Neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter as from us, as that the day of Christ is at hand. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition, who opposeth and exalted himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he as God sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Remember ye not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things? And now ye know what be withholdeth, that he might be revealed in his time. Everyone read out loud. For the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Only he who now letteth will let until he be taken out of the way. And then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming, even him whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all power, signs, lying wonders, and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they receive not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. And for this cause God shall send them strong delusion, that they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believe not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. Now, as we go back to verse number 1, as Paul is writing to the church in Thessalonica, He says, now we beseech you, or we beg you, or we plead with you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, and by our gathering together unto him. He is talking about the rapture. That is where we will all be gathered together unto him. There's an Old Testament scripture. I can't remember where it is right now. I have to get it for you later. But it is a pretty obscure scripture because it is in the middle of something that has nothing to do with what is said above it or below it. It says that God shall do a new thing in the earth. A woman shall compass a man. Now, when you think about compassing, you're talking about surrounding. And, of course, that is a prophecy of the rapture, that the church will be caught up and will compass the man, and that man will be God as Jesus Christ in his glorified body. And that is the gathering together unto him that we're waiting for, that is to take place at any time. Can we say amen? All right, and so he says, we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and by gathering unto him, verse 2, that ye be not soon shaken in mind or be troubled, neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter as from us. Well, of course, the church in Thessalonica was going through great persecution. And this is why he penned these epistles, because the persecution that they were going through was extremely severe. And he told them in 1 Thessalonians 4, don't sorrow as others which have no hope, because many of their loved ones had died, and many of them were sorrowing. They were dying because of the persecution that they were suffering. And he says, don't sorrow as others which have no hope, because them that sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. And then he went into talking about the Lord shall descend from heaven with a shout. He began to talk about the rapture. And then he says, wherefore comfort one another with these words. And it is very unfortunate that we don't preach the rapture as we ought to, because the rapture, the understanding that Jesus is coming, is supposed to be some comforting words to us. Can we say amen? Because some of us, we've gone through quite a bit in our saved lives. Many of us, some of us have lost loved ones. Me and my wife certainly lost our 18-year-old, and he hadn't even began to really live yet before he was taken out of this world as far as life is concerned. And so the thought of the rapture coming, that Jesus is coming and taking us out of the earth and back with him, us receiving eternal life, ought to be something that's comforting. But people are not really hearing that as they ought to, so therefore they're not getting the comfort that they should get, because the preacher is talking about everything else but the coming of the Lord, because he's concerned about his pockets. He's concerned about trying to get as many people as he can, because he's looking at the nominal church world and seeing all the things that they get and all the things that they have, and they think that they can bring some of those things into the church and have the same success. But that's not God's way. Paul, when he talked about the coming of the Lord and the rapture, he told the saints there to comfort one another with these words. The fact that Jesus is coming should be comforting to us. Can we say amen? Amen. To take us out of this world and take us out of all these troubles. And so he tells them, he doesn't want them to be shaken in mind, troubled, neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter as from us, as that the day of Christ is at hand. Now, if it was at hand or near 2,000 years ago, then what is it today? Now that we're 2,000 years closer, it should be something that is on our mind every day. Every day we ought to be thinking about the rapture, because that's the reason why we are in the church. That's why we gave up the sins of the world, the lifestyle of the world, because we want to be with Jesus. Can we say amen? Because if we're not in the church to be saved, then we're wasting our time. A lot of people are wasting their time because they are not focusing on living for God and not focusing on making the rapture. Their focus is on other things. But if my focus is not on going back with Jesus when he comes, I am wasting my time. I might as well go on back out in the world and do what I'm going to do, because I'm going to be lost anyway. Now, we're not telling you to go out in the world. Is that right? We're telling you to be focused on who? Jesus. Hey, praise the Lord. And so he says here, verse number 3, let's read there. Let no man deceive you by what? Any means. And of course, there are a number of means whereby people can try to deceive you. The Lord is coming. Now, of course, we had a bishop in the PAW that taught and preached that there is no such thing as a rapture. There's no such thing as a tribulation period. There is no millennial reign. There's no new heaven, new earth period. You just live and die, and that's it. Well, if that's it, why am I in the church then? Can we say amen? You know, why am I in the church? I might as well go find the next lottery line. What now? What's the next big thing? What do they call it? The jackpot? What's the big jackpot? You shouldn't even know. You're supposed to be saved. Hallelujah. I tried to trick you there for a minute. Somebody says, up to a million. I'm watching it, Bishop. Well, you should have no business watching it. Well, you can watch it, but be careful because you're going to be tempted to go play and the devil ain't going to let you win. Can we say amen? You know, but you see the point we're trying to make. Is that right? Don't let anybody deceive you. No one deceive you, not by any means. All right, concerning the rapture, let's read the coming of the Lord. Let's read. For that day shall not come except there come a what? Now we are in the falling away. We are in the falling away. And that falling away simply deals with that they are just as fast as people are getting saved, they're leaving right out of the church. They come in and get baptized and filled with the Holy Ghost, and then you don't see them anymore. Our churches are like revolving doors. We are in the great falling away. People that have been in reputation for wisdom and honor, you find out that they've fallen away. People that have perhaps witnessed to you and preached you out of sin, and then you find out that they've fallen away. You wonder what happened to them. Some of the great preachers that I came up to know, and Pastor David Johnson also came up to know, you look at them now and you say, what in the world has happened to them? They don't seem to have the power and the fervor and the anointing that they used to have. Where are we in? We're in the great what? Falling away. Falling away. People are betraying their convictions, betraying what they have been taught, betraying what they have been established in, because that's what God said. Now, people say, well, if the church is not, if the pastor can't keep people, he needs to do something. Something's wrong with him. No, we're in the great falling away. And of course, I've talked to different other pastors and bishops, and they say we need to change our methods to try to win people and try to keep people. And I told one bishop, I said, well, it's not a matter about our method. It's a matter about the signs of the end times. You cannot break the scripture. If the scripture said they're going to fall away, there's nothing that you can do to keep that from happening. The only thing you can do is save who? Yourself, because it's going to happen, all right? Because God has already seen it happen, and he gave his to his apostles and prophets, and they wrote in the scriptures based on what God has already seen, and it cannot change because it's already happened, and it's happening right now. The great falling away, first, and let's read, that man of sin be revealed, the what? Son of perdition. Now, of course, many people think that because they read this scripture, they're saying that the rapture can't take place until the son of perdition is manifested. Perdition means final ruin. And of course, there are two men in your Bible that are called the sons of perdition. You have Judas Iscariot, and then you have the Antichrist. Now, what we have to understand is that this last clause is prophecy, because our gathering together unto him will be before the son of perdition is revealed. But the falling away will happen before he comes. We're in that falling away now. And the church is going to be raptured before the Antichrist is revealed as to who he really is. And of course, that won't be to 3.5 years after the church has been raptured. The church will be raptured up. Then the Antichrist will come on the scene, who will be the devil manifest in human flesh. Just as Jesus was God in human flesh, the Antichrist will be Satan manifest in flesh. He will possess a man, and that man will rise up through the ranks politically and eventually become the leader of the nation of Israel, which the scripture lets us know he's going to be a Roman Jew. So don't think that Trump is the Antichrist. He's just acting like the Antichrist. If you say amen. But he is not the Antichrist, because the Antichrist will be the leader of the nation of Israel, because Israel is still waiting on their Messiah. They don't believe that Jesus was their Messiah. And so the temple has been destroyed in 70 AD, and Jesus prophesied that it would happen because he knew that they would reject him. And he told them that your house is left unto you desolate. And of course, their house is desolate. It happened when Titus and his army came in about 40 years after Jesus left the earth and destroyed their temple. And so, because they don't believe that Jesus was their Messiah, every day they sit at their table with an extra chair and an extra plate, because the scripture says Elias would come first before the Messiah, and they're waiting on Elias. And so this is what they're doing right now. And so when the Antichrist comes, they will receive him as their Messiah. Jesus said in St. John chapter 5, verse 43, he said, I am come in my Father's name. What name did he come in? What's his name? Jesus. He said, if another come in his own name, him you will receive. He was talking about the Antichrist, because he's going to come in his own name and they're going to receive him. Now the church is going to be gone. But many people, many Bible scholars stumble over this because it runs so concurrently that they think it's all one narrative. But when you deal with biblical prophecy, it goes here, then there, and then back and forth. And you have to rightly divide it with the other scriptures that go along with it to give you the proper timeline as to which things are going to happen. And that's what we have in verse number 3. He says, about the coming of the Lord is at hand. The day of Christ is at hand, which is the rapture. Let no man deceive you, verse 3, by any means. For that day, it is the day of Christ, shall not come, except there come a falling away first. And that man of sin be revealed, which is the son of who? Perdition. Now that gives us another time, because what we have to understand, that in this text of scripture, it deals with two comings of Jesus Christ. The rapture is in verse number 1 and 2 is what he's talking about, which accompanies the falling away. The falling away will occur before the Lord actually comes and we are gathered together unto him. But then the last clause in verse 3, he says, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. However, he's going to come again to destroy the Antichrist after he is revealed. You see it? Can we say amen? Haven't confused you yet, have I? Well, verse number 4. Who, what is he doing? Let's read. Who opposeth and exalteth himself above all that is called God. Now, who is that? That is the son of perdition, who is the anti what? Christ. When he comes, he's going to oppose and exalt himself above all that is called God or that is worship, so that he as God sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that what? He is God. Now, what temple of God? Well, the temple that Israel had has been destroyed. But when he comes on the scene, he's going to accomplish what his forefathers have never been able to do in the land in the Middle East where they're fighting. He's going to get a lot of that land back, particularly that land where the Muslim Mosque of Omar sits, where Solomon's temple was originally. And the Jews have offered the Muslims $100 million for it, and they refused to sell it. And they said, if you don't sell it to us, we're going to take it by force. Well, when the Antichrist comes, he's going to get that land back, and he's going to restore Israel's temple worship. It has to be done. Else, how can he sit in the temple of God, declare himself God, showing himself that he is God, unless the temple had been restored? So that's what's going on. That's what's going to happen. And he's going to come in and make everybody think that he is the long-awaited Messiah. He's going to deceive the whole nations of the world. The United States are going to be right there with him, because we are Israel's biggest ally. And when he comes on the scene, they're going to believe that he's the Messiah. And then he's going to turn on the entire world, go into this temple, call himself God. And then he's going to demand the whole world bow down and worship him and take the mark of the beast. And there will be untold billions of people that will take that mark of the beast and align themselves in affinity with the devil manifest in flesh. All right. Well, are you with me so far? Can we say amen? All right. Verse number 5. Remember ye not that when I was yet with you, I what? Told you these things. In other words, he's letting them know he told them these things before. All right, let's read. And now ye know what withholdeth that he might be revealed in his time. Now, who is the he there? Who is the he? Son of perdition. Now ye know what withholdeth him. What's holding him back from being revealed? What's holding him back from coming forth? What's holding him back from being manifested? Now ye know what withholdeth that he might be revealed in his time. Let's read verse 7. For the mystery of iniquity, what? Doth already work. Now, that is one of the 11 mysteries that are in the Bible. The mystery of iniquity. And now, for the mystery of iniquity already work. The mystery of iniquity is the workings of the devil. Satan works in a mysterious fashion that you don't readily recognize when he's behind certain things. It's called the mystery of iniquity. He works in a manner that is not easily detected because he's a deceiver. And so he says here, for the mystery of iniquity doth already work. The mystery of iniquity, or the devil at work, will be during the time that the Antichrist will be here or in power, but the devil is already working right now. All right? So he says, for the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Now, of course, what punctuation do we have after that? You remember? That's a colon, which means that he is not finished with the thought. Let's read. All right, you're not reading. Let's read out loud. Only he who now letteth will let until he be what? Taken out of the way. Now, the word let is one of the words that have changed in meaning since the Bible was translated into the English language in 1611. The word letteth there means to hinder, to impede, to restrain, to hold back. So he says, for the mystery of iniquity doth already work, only he who now letteth. The he is the church. Only he who now hindereth will hinder until he be taken what? Out of the way. In other words, the church is what's preventing the Antichrist from coming on the scene. And when the church is taken out of the way, this is what we have, verse number 8. Let's read. Then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness what? Of his coming. So once the church is taken out of the earth, the rapture, then this is when he comes on the scene, and 3.5 years later, he will reveal to the world who he really is. But because he will have so much control. Now, I was listening to a preacher on the radio. Me and my wife was listening. We were driving home, and he quoted a scripture out of the 10th chapter of Acts, where it says how God anointed Jesus with the Holy Ghost and with power. And he said the word power means authority. Then he says, now Satan has power, but he don't have no authority. I said, he just contradicted himself. If power means authority, and Satan's got power, that means Satan's got authority. Is he not the God of this world? Is he not the prince and the power of what? The spirit that now worketh in who? Children of disobedience. You see how people can just get twisted when they don't follow the scripture? They'll contradict themselves in the same breath, trying to prove their point. Well, we need to try to prove the point of the scripture, not try to prove our point. All right, well, the Lord's going to destroy him with the brightness of his coming. Let's read verse 10. and with all deceivableness of what? Unrighteousness. I taught a Bible class on that. The deceivableness of unrighteousness. And with all deceivableness of unrighteousness, let's read, in them that perish. In them that perish. Now, why were they deceived in unrighteousness? And why did they perish? Let's read. Because they received not the love of the truth that they what? Might be saved. I'm telling you tonight, it's very important for every one of us to not only receive the truth, but love the truth. Because anybody that does not love the truth, when he comes along, it's over. It's over. And that's why I stand so firmly on the truth. And other ministers stand firmly on the truth, not wavering. Because if you waver from the truth, if you don't love the truth, then he's going to get many people. And you have a lot of preachers today that preach but don't love the truth. How do we know they don't love the truth? Because they don't follow it. They only follow certain parts of it. They only follow certain segments of it. And one preacher, he's a friend of mine, Baptist preacher. And, of course, I was talking to another friend of mine who he was preaching at her church. And we was all working at the prison together. And she said, you know, so-and-so did a good job preaching, but he said something that I don't agree with. I said, please tell me. I would like to hear that. He said he don't agree with everything that Jesus said in the Bible. She said, I have a problem with that. I said, I can understand that. But you have a lot of preachers like that. A lot of them not bold enough to say it, but they do say that to some degree. If we don't love the truth, the order of God, and he comes, I'll use myself as an example so you won't get hurt. If I don't love this truth and my obedience to it tells how much I love it. If I don't love it, then when the Lord comes, I'm left and I'm in trouble. I'm in trouble. I remember one time I woke up and a voice said to me, you missed the rapture. Look outside. I got sick and almost fainted. I got up and looked outside too. I said, the devil, you demon. I hate the devil. I don't know about you. I hate him. I hate everything about him and everything he stands for. Hate his, if he has some guts, I hate his guts. You know, so, but if we miss it, if we miss it, I thought one day, I said, if I haven't missed the rapture, I think I'd commit suicide. I don't know. I don't want to, I don't even like thinking about it. But I'm telling you, we need to love God's word, and our obedience to it demonstrates whether we love it or not. If we're not obedient to it, we don't love it. We can say whatever we want to say, but God is looking at our heart. He's looking at our obedience to his word. And there are many people, and you think about a lot of preachers that go out non-denominational, a lot of preachers that go out preaching all kinds of stuff. I don't agree with organization. I don't agree with having being accountable to anybody. I'm accountable to God. That's not loving the truth. Because the apostolic order of God is in the scriptures. That's why we're apostolic. Apostolic means we follow the teachings of the apostles as they received it from Jesus Christ. I was listening to old tape of Bishop Paddock as I was coming to church tonight, and he was answering a question out of 1 Corinthians chapter 3, where Paul said, the grace of God which is given unto me as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation, and another buildeth thereon. But let every man take heed how he builds thereupon. The every man that is to take heed how he builds is the pastor. And the pastor is supposed to build on the foundation that the apostles laid. And they do that by their preaching and teaching. And we build on the foundation that they laid by following the same practices of preaching and teaching that they received of Jesus Christ. You see, Jesus trained them how to lay the foundation. And that foundation was laid by them going out and preaching and teaching the six principles of the doctrine of Christ. When they wrote the New Testament, that was part of them laying the foundation. And so if I'm going to take heed how I preach and teach in my church, or any pastor, I have to teach and preach based upon the foundation that they laid, which means I got to preach the same thing they preached. I got to teach the same thing that they taught. I got to live the same way that they taught how you're supposed to live, because everything that they got it from who? Now, if I'm teaching something different, I'm not teaching on the foundation. If I'm preaching something different, then I'm not preaching based on the foundation. I'm not following them. It don't matter what the name of my church is. It doesn't matter how well I can preach. It doesn't matter how many folk I got following me. It doesn't matter. None of that matters. If I'm not teaching and preaching what they taught, I'm not building and teaching on the foundation. And when Jesus comes, I'm in trouble. I'm in trouble. That's why I don't care what nobody thinks about when I teach. I care about what God thinks. Because I ain't been in this for no 37 years to miss it. I've been through too much to miss it in the end. How about you? So because they did not receive the love of the truth, Paul says, with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish. Those that don't receive the truth now, when that happens, they're going to perish. Because they would not receive the truth, receive not the love of the truth. They didn't receive it because they didn't love it. Verse number 11. And for this cause, for what cause? Because they received not the love of the truth that they might be saved, God shall what? Send them a what? Strong delusion that they should believe what? Now, will God do something like that? Well, God is a loving God. God is not going to put anybody in hell. He's a God of love. And that's what Bishop Golder made that point many years ago. That because God shows so much love and mercy and grace to the extent that the world thinks that's all that he is. That's all that he is. And the scriptures, if you study this entire Bible, you will find that God's judgment is spoken of more than his love and his mercy and his grace. And just as loving and merciful and graceful he is, there's another side to him. And that side the world will see, that he's not just some genie that whatever you say or do, or however much money you pay, you can get him to do whatever you want him to do. That's not how it is. He's going to show another side of him. And that's the side we don't want no part of. Can you say amen? But they don't believe it. They don't believe it. When I was doing that radio broadcast, when the homosexuals was ambushing me on that radio show in California, I said, God's judgment is against sin. I thought the woman was going to pass out on the phone. What? He's a God of love. I said, that's why y'all deceived. You think that's all he is. I said, what about the scripture that says the wages of sin is death? I said, what about the psalmist when he says what is that scripture? That God's going to turn the nations into hell and all of them that forget him. I said, what about the scripture where it says, and hell hath enlarged herself and opened her mouth without measure? What about Revelation and the smoke of their torment ascended up forever and ever? And you should have heard those gays, well, they all jumped on me then. He's not like that. I said, who is that? And so they all talked, didn't give me no chance. I think I still got the podcast somewhere. Maybe I'll let y'all hear it. And they did all that talking, didn't give me no time to talk. And people were listening from all over the country. And they said, well, we're going to get Pastor Johnson last word to say. What do you have to say? I said, you all are going to the lake that burns with fire and brimstone if you don't repent. Have a nice day. And hung up. And turned my radio off because I didn't want to hear no more. But they think that that's all God is. Oh, no, that ain't. I mean, you can be nice, right? There's another side of you, ain't it? chuckles and giggles. Now, the sweetest woman I know is my wife. But she can get with you when she has to. Want me to testify? I'm not telling you nothing. And we're in the image of who? God. We're in the image of God. Praise the Lord. So, God, verse 11, and for this cause God shall send them a what kind of delusion? In Isaiah, he says he will choose their delusions. And of course, if God gives a person a strong delusion, there ain't nobody that can take it off. And for this cause, why? Because they would not receive the love of the truth as it was taught by the apostles when they laid the foundation. They had their own opinions. They had a vision that told them something different. They got one of the lost books of the Bible and read something else. Well, and for this cause, and that's the problem that we have today. There are some walking around today with a strong delusion. And you can't tell them anything different because of strong illusion. Now, how many of y'all remember Reverend Ike? Did you know Reverend Ike was baptized in Jesus' name and filled with the Holy Ghost under the late Bishop R.C. Lawson, who started and founded the Churches of Our Lord Jesus Christ headed for many years by the late Bishop William L. Bonner? He left out of Refuge Temple and defected from the faith. And he boasted that he was the first prosperity preacher. He probably was, because he came out in what, late 50s, early 60s? And did untold amount of damage to people. And you could not convince him any other way, because God had given him a strong delusion that he will be or might be damned. Jim Jones was baptized in Jesus' name, filled with the Holy Ghost. I believe he was with the UPC. And, of course, his church was right around the corner from Dr. Ershine, not the one that recent, but it was his father. Can't remember his name. However, Dr. Ershine, he sat down with Jim Jones and tried to talk to him for about 5 hours not to go down to South America and take that church down to South America. And of course, he, Jim Jones, spoke to Dr. Ershine and said, "You know what, Dr. Ershine? One day, the whole world is going to know about me and about my works. You're still going to be a little pastor, pastoring a little church around the corner." Well, he was half right, because that slaughter happened in 1978, and we're still talking about it to this day. What were some of the characteristics of him? He deviated from the truth. He went independent. God has made no provision for anybody to be saved all by themselves. There is no provision. That's not building on the foundation. Well, God shall, for this cause, God shall send them a strong delusion that they should believe a lie. Verse 12, that they all might be damned who believed not the truth, but had pleasure in what? Pleasure in unrighteousness. And that's what we are faced with today. That's what we have to be careful of today. We must follow the word of God as it is taught and rightly divided. We're in the most dangerous times right now. There used to be an era of persecution, but now the order of our day is deception. And anybody that is deceived, one characteristic concerning all of those that have been deceived that are in common, they all believe they're doing what God told them to do. And many of them have received a strong delusion. So that is the importance of the truth. You see, when you turn from the truth, you turn to something else, because there is nothing else. And Jesus said, "I am the way, I am the what? Truth." So when you turn from him, then you turn to the alternative. And that's the devil. That makes sense? Because there's nothing else to turn to. It's either heaven Oh, hell, if I reject, if I decide to get off the path to heaven, then there's only one other path. Jesus talked about two gates. One is straight and narrow. One is wide and broad. You know why one is straight and narrow? Because only a few are going to go down that gate. And the one that is wide and broad, he said, many therein, many go in thereat. So there are going to be more people lost than those that are saved, because there's only going to be a few. And that's why Jesus said, as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the days of what? Come, Son of Man. Man had been on the earth for 1,656 years. And all that preaching he did for 100 years, only seven people got saved. Can you imagine? And you can't say that just because Noah only had seven members in his church, he wasn't a great preacher. See, that's where we, if you don't have a big church, you ain't preaching nothing. You lying. That's a lie from the pit. Because the man preached longer than anybody I know has ever preached, 100 years, and only eight of them made it. And you can't say that he wasn't preaching in the Spirit, because the Bible says he preached as the Spirit of Christ was upon him. He was perfect in his generations, found grace in the eyes of the Lord. Noah walked with God. But the word that he preached many times is not to save. Sometimes the word we preach, because God knows that certain people are not going to get saved, so the word is preached as a witness against them. See, the word of God can either be for you or it could be against you. But we determine what we want the word to be for us. It's for me if I'm obedient. It's against me if I reject it. And of course, that's the era that we're living in. So corruption is what the enemy's trying to bring to us, trying to corrupt our thoughts, trying to corrupt our mind, trying to corrupt our belief system, trying to corrupt what we know is true, raising doubts and uncertainty in us when it comes to the order of God. And we become like Eve. We began to continue to listen instead of resisting. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 3 through 5. Second Corinthians chapter 10. All right. Second Corinthians 10, verse 3 through 5. We've got about 15 minutes. All right. And let's read. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. In other words, the flesh here, it has to do with the word flesh is used in two ways, naturally and metaphorically. When it is used metaphorically, it has to deal with our fallen sinful nature. But here he's not dealing with it in metaphorically, he's dealing with it naturally. It means that we, as human beings, we live and behave as human beings. For though we walk in the flesh, he says next, we do not war what? After the flesh. In other words, though we live as natural human beings, our warfare and our fight is not with natural human beings. All right, verse 4. For the weapons of our warfare are not what? Carnal. Now, the fact he mentions here is that we are at war. And we are at war with the powers of darkness. Where does the war occur at? Well, he's going to tell us as we read on. Weapons of our warfare are not carnal. You can't fight the devil with carnal weapons. Let's read. But mighty through God to the pulling down of what? Strongholds has to do with strongholds that occur in the mind. The enemy comes in and takes control of a person's mind. which means that they have received a false spirit that is influencing how they think, how they reason, how they logic, and therefore affects how they behave. That's where the warfare is. It occurs first in our mind. Isn't that how he communicated with Eve? Didn't he deal with Eve in her mind? Weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are, our weapons are mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, verse 5, casting down imaginations. Where does imaginations occur? In the mind. Let's read. And every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God that is in the mind, let's read, and bring it into captivity, every thought to the obedience of who? Christ. So the thoughts that we have in our mind, that's where the war takes place. Because the enemy, when he comes to attack our thinking. And our weapons that we must use has to be mighty through God, which would be the word of God, through the power of the Holy Ghost, to bring every thought into the obedience of Christ or in line with the scriptures. You follow? All right? Because that's where he comes. And it says, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God. The knowledge of God that is in his word. The enemy will come in and talk to a person and deceive them and cause them to allow the knowledge of God in their minds to be corrupted, and they will exalt themselves above what the Bible says as what they're supposed to do. God's order, God's purpose, God's plan, God's will. Because anytime I entertain thoughts that are contrary to God's word and I follow and walk in those thoughts, I have exalted my mind above the knowledge of God. Because what, in other words, I've put what I want to do or what I'm thinking above what God has said or what God is thinking. Do you see it? And so he is saying, mighty through God, our warfare has to be mighty through God. Our weapons must be mighty through God, pulling down strongholds, casting out imaginations, and every high thing that exalted itself against, we'll say, the word of God. This is where our knowledge is. The knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of who? And if I'm bringing it into the obedience of Christ, that means I am being obedient to what his word says I should do or what should not do. That makes sense? All right. Well, that's why we must screen and challenge every thought that comes to our mind. Because the heart, the mind, is deceitful, Jeremiah said, and above all things, and desperately wicked. Who can know it? He says, I, the Lord, that search the heart and try the reins, even to give to every man according to his works. You can't trust your gut feeling sometime. You can't trust your thoughts sometime. Put your trust in who? And how do you do that? Follow this book. Believe what it says. Can we say amen? Well, our thoughts must be brought into the obedience of the word of God. And that's why he told the Philippian church, think on things that are lovely, things that are true, things that are honest, things that are pure, things that are right, things that have good report. Because if there be any virtue, any praise, think on these things. Once we got saved, we had to work on our thoughts. It takes some work being saved. You don't have to work to get saved, but you got to work to what? Stay saved. Some of us had a hard time getting saved. I know I did. But when I gave up, he came on in. Didn't it happen to you? Yeah, so our thoughts have got to be trained. And Philippians 4 tells us how we're supposed to do it. think on things. Is it 4 or 2? One of those scriptures. Look them both up. Chapter 4 and chapter 2. You'll get there. Can we say amen? Train us as how we are to think. Think. All right? And so that's what we must do. These things must be broken in our minds and bring our thinking and our logic into the obedience of Jesus Christ, because that's how the devil comes to corrupt us. Romans chapter 8, verse 5 through 9. Romans chapter 8. Oh, the devil is deceitful. The devil's deceit is beyond human comprehension. How do we know that? Look on the news and they say a man that goes out and shoot kids. How could he do that? That's because the devil's deceit is beyond human comprehension. His wickedness and his evil is beyond what man can ever understand. If we're ever going to understand it, it is only as God reveals it to us out of his word. Romans chapter 8, verse 5 through 9. We've got about 7 minutes. All right. Let's read there together. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh. Now he's using the word flesh in a metaphor. The word flesh here has to do with the fallen nature, the sinful nature that we all inherited from our father Adam, that we still have right now. You see, all of the evil and sin that is in the common sinner, that is in the sinner outside, is still in us. It's in our nature. The only difference between us and them is that it's being kept under the control of the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Can I get a witness out there? Yeah. So he says here in verse 5, for they that are after the flesh, in other words, they that live after the dictates of the sinful nature, do mind the things after the sinful what? Nature. That's why they don't want to come to church. That's why they don't want to do right. That's why they don't want to pray. That's why they want to live holy. That's why they don't want to, do the right thing, because they are operating after the dictates of the flesh or the fallen nature. No saint has any business doing that. But we have some that do. Not in this church, though. I'm being facetious when I say that. Hopefully not in this church. But there are some that still do. They think after the fallen nature dictates to them how to think. They react, and their behavior is based upon the influence of the fallen nature. And if we have the Holy Ghost, our behavior and our thought should not be after the flesh. It should be as it is dictated to or under the influence of the Spirit. Can we say amen? All right, so he says, for they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh as them in the world. Let's read. But they that are after the Spirit, that's the Spirit of God, the things of what? Spirit of God. Now that I'm saved, the only things I'm concerned about is the things of God, not the things of the world. Because I have been born of the Spirit now. When I was born of the flesh, that's all I thought about. But now that I'm born again of the water and of the Spirit, I'm supposed to be of the things of the Spirit. I'm supposed to think, live, behave, act after the influence of the Holy Ghost. Let's read on. For to be carnally minded is what? Death. Now, carnally minded means after the dictates of the fallen nature, or having the same kind of a mind that I had before I came to Christ. All right? That kind of a mind brings about what? Death. Let's read. What to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is what? Life and peace. Now, we weren't supposed to read that sixth verse, but since we already read it, we'll say this. We're supposed to go all the way to verse 9. Our mind, we still have our carnal mind because we still have our fallen nature. But the challenge is not to act, live, think, behave based on the carnal mind. It's to act, think, behave based after the Holy Spirit. So we have taken ourselves, since we're saved, not to behave after the fallen nature, but to behave after the nature of God. Can we say amen? Because, let's read on. It's carnal minded, but to be carnal minded is death. But to be spiritually minded is what? Life and peace. Verse 7. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed what? Our carnal mind, our mind is against God by nature. That's why we have to fight it and bring every thought into the obedience of who? Christ. Because our mind naturally is contrary to God. It's not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So if you have a saint of God that won't act right in the church, won't do what the pastors say do, won't do what the church officials say do, just won't do right, it's because they're behaving after the carnal mind. And as long as they're behaving after the carnal mind is not subject to God. It can't be. The carnal mind in of itself cannot obey God. You see that? Because it takes the Holy Ghost for a person to surrender to the Holy Ghost in order to obey God. So if you get an unruly saint that just won't act right, that's because they are acting under the dictates of the carnal mind, and they won't follow God's order, because they can't follow God's order as long as they are in the state of carnality. Because the carnal mind is God's enemy, it's not subject to the law of God, it cannot be subject to God's law. Well, we're almost finished. Verse 8. So then they that are in the flesh cannot what? Now again, he uses the word flesh in a metaphoric fashion. In other words, they that are acting and behaving and thinking after the dictates of the fallen nature cannot please who? God. They cannot please God because their actions are not based on faith. And faith is God's word believed. And the Hebrew writer says, 11th chapter of Hebrews says, without faith, it is impossible to what? That's because they're being carnal. That's because they're operating after the dictates of the fallen nature. And that's what the enemy tries to get us to do. Challenge everything that is in the Bible. Well, let's read on. Last verse, verse 9. But ye are not in the flesh. In other words, you are not walking after the dictates of your unsaved behavior anymore, or dictates of the flesh. Ye are not in the flesh. Let's read. But in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God does what? Dwell in you. Now, do you have the Holy Ghost? Raise your hand. You got the Holy Ghost. So the Spirit of God is where? As long as you walk after the Spirit of God dictates how you should walk, as is revealed from his word, you will not be walking after the flesh. You'll be walking where? In the Spirit. And then you can please God. But if I walk contrary to that, then I cannot please God. But ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you. Let's read. Now if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is what? You know why? Because he is operating after the dictates of God's enemy, and therefore they become God's enemy. That's why everybody is not a child of who? As many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the what? Sons of God. They're not even a Christian. You can't be a Christian without the Holy Ghost, because you cannot please God after the carnal nature. The mind is not even subject, because the word Christian means to be owned by Christ. And if I have not been baptized in Jesus' name filled with the Holy Ghost, I am none of his. Isn't that what the Bible says? If any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is what? So why do we preach Baptist preachers at our conventions? Why do we preach Methodist preachers in our conventions? Why do we do all of that? Because everybody ain't going to be saved. Can we say amen? And everybody's not building on the foundation that the apostles have established. And God's going to get a lot of people, and a lot of them going to be preachers. But he ain't going to get me. Because I'm going to hear him say, well done, my good and faithful servant. I'm going to say, Lord, what planet do I get as my reward? Hallelujah. And that's all the time we have tonight. All right. Hope you got something out this lesson tonight. Praise the Lord. Help us make it. Can we say amen? Are there any questions tonight? Yes, ma'am. And what does that scripture say? Thank you. That's Jeremiah what? Jeremiah 31. Thank you very much, Prophetess Neil. God bless you. No, she's just a Bible student. God bless you. Thank you for that scripture. I'm using a new Bible, so it ain't marked in here. But y'all get that scripture? That's a good scripture. Powerful scripture. Anybody else? Any questions? All right. Well, now that we've terrified you, we don't want you to be terrified because you're going with Jesus, right? Amen. You're going in the rapture, is that right?
Yes, sir.
Oh, yeah. Hallelujah. Glory to his name. All right, well, we're going to prepare to take our offering. Now, we want to know how many want to go to the Haitian Dominican Council.